Hachette Audio presents No Crying in Baseball, the inside story of a league of their own. Big stars, dugout drama, and a home run for Hollywood. Written by Erin Carlson, read by Mia Hutchinson Shaw. For Poppy. Go get 'em, Tiger. I have never wanted to grow up and stop playing. Penny Marshall. Introduction. Dirt in the skirt. Gina Davis stepped up to home plate. She bent her knees, wrapped her hands around the bat, and tried to keep her eye on the ball as the camera rolled in silent judgment. The camera. It saw everything and missed nothing. It exposed her as exactly what she was. An actress, the ultimate imposter, pretending to be a baseball player with superhuman ability and coming up awfully short. All the training in the world couldn't turn Gina into a professional athlete, nor could her rarefied status as an Oscar winner hide the truth. That there, on a hot, dusty ball field in the middle of nowhere, thousands of miles from the smog and mirrors and palm tree shade of Los Angeles, she was merely a rookie. Every actress in Hollywood wanted her role, the audacity to believe they had what it took. Gina had practiced hard for weeks. Elite coaches schooled her in the basics of America's storied pastime, instructing their eager student how to hit and catch and throw. The throwing for her was the trickiest. Without doing damage to that face, those cheekbones, her moneymaker, her foot in the door. On this day, her first at bat, she was supposed to smack a home run. Things were not going well. Pitch after pitch, take after take, Gina kept swinging with dismal results. The ball wouldn't go where it needed to go. Penny Marshall, her director, paced back and forth behind the camera, a cigarette dangling from her mouth. "Oh my God, hit the ball, put me out of my misery," she complained. "Penny, that's not helping," Gina said. It was the summer of 1991, and Penny's trademark whine, to some endearing, to others exasperating, provided the soundtrack while she filmed A League of Their Own in the Midwest. Studio executives held their breath. Of course, Penny was talented. She had a special nose for what the masses wanted to see on the big screen. She hadn't gone to film school, nor could she explain the difference between this lens and that. She lacked the pretensions of aesthetes who won Oscars. Instead, she went for the emotional jugular without apology, intermingling happy and sad, good taste, and schmaltz. That was the Marshall way. While grappling with self-doubt and a hostile crew, Penny had managed to make Big into a runaway success, and in the process, she became the first woman director to gross more than $100 million at the box office. But among the corner office set, she was often considered an expensive financial risk. She would go to grueling lengths to get the best shot, wasting countless reels of film. Big, an intimate set, had nothing on the scope and scale of A League of Their Own, which found Penny outnumbered by actresses who couldn't play ball, not to mention their ringers, the ballplayers who couldn't act. How much money would she burn to capture convincing footage? Could Penny, hell, anyone, be trusted to deliver a decent movie about an obscure women's baseball league from the 1940s? And since men were assumed to enjoy sports movies more than their wives, girlfriends, and daughters, were ordinary Joes actually going to buy tickets? With Gina, and not Kevin Costner behind the plate, the doubts amplified. What transpired between Gina's at-bat and Penny's final cut would silence the skeptics and defy conventional logic, especially when it was revealed that young girls adored the Rockford peaches, memorizing the lyrics to the victory song that drove the crew nuts. An irresistible underdog tale featuring a rare female-led ensemble cast. A League of Their Own broke the mold to become the most record-breaking baseball movie of all time. In hindsight, its appeal was obvious. But with anything new and untested, the unknowns piled up. Even Tom Hanks was a wild card. After a series of flops, he'd done what leading men like Costner and Cruise and Schwarzenegger almost never did back then. He demoted himself to character actor. He begged Penny to let him sulk in the dugout as the surly, drunken coach Jimmy Dugan, and she agreed despite studio reluctance. Then there was Madonna. How did the biggest pop star in the world not go stir-crazy during the 88-day shoot in Illinois and Indiana? The blonde ambition button pusher who ignited scandal amid the cornfields yearned for New York City. Nobody, not least of all Penny Marshall, could have ever envisioned that A League of Their Own would endure as a love letter to baseball and the real women who had played it professionally. Penny, a tormented soul with a relaxed exterior, initially dismissed much of her work as crap. She spotted weaknesses rather than triumphs. So how did she plunge onward while doing battle with the critical voices in her head? What made her take a chance on Tom? How did he and Penny handle Madonna the provocateur? How did Gina master the physics of catching a pop fly behind her back? This book is the untold story of a time before the internet, when filming on location was a traveling circus and untamed behavior went unchecked. When a filmmaker and her motley collaborators, throwing vanity out the window, got some dirt in their skirts and hit one out of the park. First inning. An underdog and insider. Charlie Wessler trembled as he prepared to tell Penny the cold, hard truth. They smoked outside the stage at Paramount Studios while she taped the last episode of Laverne and Shirley, the mega-popular, critically panned ABC sitcom that made her a household name. In 1983, the show, which centered on two women roommates who paid the rent by capping bottles at the fictional Schatz Brewery, was ending its seven-year run. The ratings had dwindled. Cindy Williams, who played the bubbly Shirley Feeney to Penny's deadpan Laverne DeFazio, had walked off in protest, pregnant with her first child. The suits in charge, patriarch Tony Marshall included, refused to write in a pregnancy for Shirley, which would have been an easy solution to a happy problem, right? Right. But things were different back then. Different and yet the same. Penny did the final season solo. Then the suits pulled the plug. After all that backstage drama, Penny was ready to leave Laverne behind. Laverne, however, wasn't done with Penny. The two characters, one real, the other a heightened version of the real, were inextricably linked. Penny loved drinking milk with Pepsi, and so did Laverne. Penny knew how to tap dance, as did Laverne. Both spoke with a lethargic Bronx accent and eviscerated fools in their midst with a withering look. Where did Penny end and Laverne begin? The lines blurred. People saw Penny on the street, even in Paris, and yelled, "Laverne!" Given this deep-seated association with her alter ego, Wessler doubted whether she'd be able to land major roles playing not Laverne's. He had met Penny through his friend, Carrie Fisher, with whom he attended Beverly Hills High School. While Wessler aimed to become a movie producer, he realized that reaching his goal could take time. He decided to try his hand at managing talent instead. Actress Arlene Sorkin, who was Wessler's girlfriend, and improv comic Julia Sweeney were his first clients. He wanted Penny to be his third. It was time to make his move. "Look," he told Penny, You understand that when you leave this show, no one's gonna hire you as an actress. All they know is you're Laverne, and that's the only thing they're gonna be able to remember and know about you. He predicted the rejections. No, we don't want to hire her to be in our movie because she's Laverne. Penny's reaction to the truth-telling? She gave a lackluster, eh. Deep down, she knew her limitations as a performer. I'm not going to be doing Shakespeare in the Park, she joked later. To keep her life interesting and stay relevant in a creative community filled with smart, funny, successful people, particularly the smart, funny, successful men whose company she craved, then she had to do something different.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.